I mean, he led me to where they were. He said, look up, look under that hat, boom, there they were. And they do that 7 to 8 times out of 10, it will come to fruition. And the 2 or 3 times that they don't answer your request, you must understand God has a better plan and give it your faith. But the odds are great, 7 times out of 10. Let me give you an example, Alex. I love this one. The other day, I went to my assistant's house. Her name is Elena. She's not just my assistant, she's one of my best friends. But I went to her house and she said, I lost my sunglasses. I can't find them. I had them for years. I love them. I said, well, did you look in your car? Because I see them in your car. She goes, I looked a million times in my car. I said, no, they're in your car. They're in the car. They're in the car. Okay, she went outside. She came back 10 minutes later. She goes, and she's a neat freak, not like a lot of junk in her car. She goes,
I'd like to welcome to the show Concetta Bertoldi. How are you doing, Concetta?
I'm wonderful, darling. How are you?
I'm good, my dear. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I am so excited to talk to you about your journeys in the insane worlds of psychic mediumship and all the journeys and all the things that you've done in your life. Talk about one of your books, Do Dead People Watch You Shower? Which is only to be bested by I Kissed a Ghost and I Liked It. Your titles for your books are absolutely amazing. And
Thank you.
I knew I just know that this conversation is going to be a lot of fun. So first question I have for you is, were you born with, well, obviously you were born with it, but did you know about your gifts early on, or is that something that developed later on in life?
Well, my father, when he was alive, told the story that my father's father, who also had an amazing ability, told him when my mother was pregnant that I would also have this ability. So my father was on the lookout for it from the very beginning. But he didn't say anything to my mother because he didn't want to frighten her. They were different religions, different ethnic backgrounds. So she wasn't familiar with this. And the way she was raised, she would have been very frightened of this. So this happened. It was sprung on her one day. I was only 5. I came in from playing and I said, Mommy, Uncle Jerry's leg is gone and it's all bloody. And my mother, that was her first experience. She used to love to tell the story. And she said, what a horrible thing for a little girl to say. Why did you say that? And then the phone rang and it was my mother's sister-in-law, my uncle's wife, and he was in a motorcycle accident and they were asking permission to amputate his leg. And she called my mother to, she didn't know what to do. And I walked in from the backyard and said that to my mother before the phone rang. So
What
she knew there was
happened?
something up. Well,
Yeah, with her at that
fortunately,
point.
yeah, thank God he didn't lose his leg, but they saved it. But the point is, at that moment, my mother and father had the talk because my father then had to, sit her down and tell her what to expect. And it really was, I don't remember any of that, by the way. I remember little bits and pieces, though, as I was maybe 9 and 10, because my mother became very comfortable with the fact that I had this ability through my father's guidance, because he knew it was okay. He knew what to expect. So my mother, though, got very comfortable in this sense. When there was a neighbor who had a problem or a death in the family, I would come home from school. There'd be somebody I didn't know in the living room, and she would be like, can you come here and can you talk to this lady? Her so-and-so died and tell her anything. So I always tell people, now I have a very vulgar way of saying it, but I'm from Jersey, so I have excuses. I say she used to pimp me out, but that was because she'd call me in and say, would you talk and say something? Maybe I shouldn't have said that, but I meant
No.
it
I completely understand what you're saying, but isn't it
that
interesting that, again, I've told this on the show before that the gift runs in my family. I don't have it, but
Ah.
it ran in my mother's side of the family. My grandmother had it, and her grand and I think her sisters
Yeah.
had versions of this. But
Yes.
early on, it's something you wouldn't talk about. It would be
No.
exactly the way you, it's exactly what you said. A friend would tell a friend, they would come over, it
Yes.
would be done behind closed doors. It
Yes.
was very quiet. You would never advertise.
No, darling.
You would
I
never
used to.
go on a show and talk about
No.
it like this.
Oh my God. I always joke, I have a rich sense of humor, so you forgive me, please. But I tell people, I'm just grateful it's 2023, because if this was like 1798, they'd already have a fire going down at the center of town for me, you know? So yes, you're absolutely right. We are in the 21st century, and I feel the biggest discovery of this century is spirituality. It is the biggest discovery.
Would you agree that the consciousness of humanity in general has shifted so dramatically in the last 10 years?
Oh, absolutely. In the last 20, 25 years. Absolutely.
It's been moving a lot, but I think in the last 10, it's actually, it's accelerating even more.
Picked up speed. Yes.
It is picked up speed because, and I've said this before, but it's like, this show doesn't make sense 10 years ago.
Right. Exactly. That's why I love podcasts.
I thank you. But it, like something like this, these conversations, people weren't kind of ready for this, you know, and I have.
You've given it a platform, Alex.
It's something that's what I try to do with the show, is I try to bring people on and have serious conversations about these things, because, you know, yes, we've all heard of the charlatans. We all heard of the people who bring a bad name to channeling or to psychic mediumship or even to near-death experiences or any of these kind of things. But, you know, when you talk to people who really do have the gift and you get into the weeds with it, it's really, for me, it's fascinating because I don't have the gift. So I always, but I've been around it. And in my culture, I'm a Latino. So my culture, it's inbred, it's in our DNA as in Latin America, spirituality and psychic mediumships. And, you know, like, and you would always have the, go to Aunt Jane, Aunt Jane will, you know, this or that, or, you know, and only years later, actually, after I launched the show, my mom's the one who told me, like, oh, grandma had it. I'm like, what? She's like, oh, yeah, so did your aunt here and this other aunt there. And I'm like, really? Mm-hmm. And she's like, oh, yeah, we just wouldn't talk about it. You can't talk about things like that.
That's right.
So as you're growing up, you're dealing with, are you seeing dead people like in Ghost? Are they all just hanging around in Sixth Sense? Like, how did you do it as you grow up?
Well, first, let me just say something to you. You do have the ability, honey, but you call it a gut feeling or even a coincidence. But my favorite is something just told me, you know, but you do have, we all do. We all have this ability.
Sure.
And it's just that when it's like anything else, if you were first given a bike and it was a two wheeler and they said you can ride this bike down the street and you never saw one before. And then someone encouraged you and you took a ride or you started to test it and you were fumbling, falling, but you kept at it. You got better and better and better. Next thing you know, you're running races down the street. It's like anything else. When you exercise it and use it, you will see more of it. And because I've always known that I heard dead people, I was fortunate because I had a father who was so accepting. And he early on told me how to protect myself, what it was that it was happening, so I wasn't frightened. And that was a real great. And I also was raised by two people who were so incredibly wonderful about differences in this world. As I said, there were two different religions, two different ethnic backgrounds. They were accepting of all people. They had no prejudices at all. So my mother and father didn't raise us really a religion. They said, my brothers and I, they said to us, when you get old enough and choose a religion, we'll follow every one of them and we'll celebrate every one of them. So to have folks like that raise a person with this ability was the perfect. I feel like I had the perfect storm to be able to do what I'm doing, because I'm open, you know, to all the possibilities, all the love that's out there. So I've had a lot of fun with it. And if I had a problem, I would go to my father, you know, but he was the one who encouraged me to know that they were there to help me and that I was different, to be honest.
And then how did you deal with, you know, going through school and, you know, those early years, elementary, middle, high school, when you just want to kind of, you know, be one of the crowd. And yet you're hearing and seeing dead people. And then I'm assuming at one point or another, you go, oh, wait a minute.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone can't see this.
That's correct. You are so right, my dear. Well, one thing it did do was because of this ability as a young girl, you're right, I told very few people. My family knew, but friends-wise, I didn't go around telling people, hey, I have your grandmother on. You want to talk to her? I didn't do that. I chose very wisely the friends that I selected to socialize with. And, you know, I, just like anybody else in a young age, all I wanted to do was wear lipstick and find boys. So the last thing I ever thought I'd ever be doing is reading people, you know, listen for dead people around people. I didn't know the value of it. I didn't understand what it could do for people's lives in those young years. So I took it for granted for a very long time as a young girl. But the friends I had young, I still have to this day. Because I could trust them. They didn't betray me when I confessed to them, you know, that I had this ability. They stuck by me and didn't make fun of me and didn't tell other, you know, kids we hung out with. Because, you know, I mean, listen, I'm honest. I don't care about much in terms of what people think of what I look like, whatever. So I openly admit everything. If I had plastic surgery and my age, I tell you, I'm 70 years old. So I've been around long enough. I can tell you that, and by the way, I know I look great.
I was about to say, but you beat me to it.
I'm joking, of course. But the truth is, I've been around long enough to know that people can be very mean and they can hurt you when you have confidence. They would really like to bring you down a few. In Jersey, we say this, people want to see you get ahead, just not ahead of them. So early on, I learned, you know, where I could trust and how to handle things that were thrown at me. But I like to embrace everything. So that's why I tell, my favorite thing is women. I mean, I'm married. I love women, though. I'm married to a man, by the way. I don't know if that all came out right. But I love women in this sense. I want to make a difference in letting them know to have self-confidence. Because there was always so much put upon me, and women have been put upon from the beginning of time. But especially in my lifetime, I've seen what magazines and what Hollywood projects as beautiful and perfect and stunning. And I like to make a difference in women's lives that they have self-confidence and believe in themselves. And I have a tremendous amount of that. That's why I openly admit my age. I don't care because I like me and I like the way I look. So if you walk in the room with those two things in your head, that walks in before you and it comes across that way in a nice way because I'm not a brat.
So as you're going through life, at what point did you decide to come out of the psychic closet, if you will?
I'll tell you what happened there. So I had a brother who was, he was what we call Irish twins. He was 11 months, there was 11 months between us. And he passed away when he was 38 of AIDS. And it was so devastating to my family. And we were very close. And when he died, he came to me immediately and said, "You must help us. Please deliver these messages." And I said to him, "Honey, I don't have the slightest idea how to go out there and just say to the world, here I am. I hear dead people." I didn't even know what to do with that. By the way, he was 38. I was 37. I just told you I'm 70. So it happened a long time ago. And I said, "All right, what should I do?" And he said, "All you have to do is say, yes, you'll help us, agree to help us. We'll take it from there." I didn't even know what he could do. I mean, you know, this was the first person I had loved and lost. Both my parents, thank God, were still here. They both joined him. Now I call them affectionately my God squad. And in all fairness, he took over. He brought me to unbelievable. It was like everything just fell into place. It was absolutely amazing, Alex. Nothing short of a miracle as I see it. I was never a bright student in school. I never went to college. And I just, what I did was somebody said to me, "Get tarot cards and say you're reading tarot cards," because I didn't know how to go in front of a person and just do what I do at that time. I was only in my early 40s, but I got tarot cards and I used them as a disguise. Like, people thought I was reading tarot cards, but I wasn't. I was looking above them and listening to the dead folks around them until finally somebody said to me, "Well, I don't see that in the cards. And what about this card and that card?" I had no idea what I was doing with those cards. I didn't read them. So I had to say, "I don't read them really. I'm listening to something else." And when the person, my subject, said to me, "Well, what are you listening to?" I said, "There's dead people around you." You know, and then I told them, the person was happy. I said, "I got to throw these cards out and just be honest." So I threw the cards out and I said, "I hear dead people." And I figured, what could happen? What's the worst that could happen? They don't like me. They don't believe me. They can make fun of me. I'll take it on. I don't care. And I did. And from there, it just was mind blowing how it changed. Really, I amazed myself.
You're Jersey tough. You're Jersey tough. No question yeah. about it. Yeah, you're like you said earlier, what's the worst can happen? They're not burning you at the stake right now, thank God.
Really.
You know, so
not Salem, Alex, it's New Jersey.
It's Jersey, not Salem. So can you describe to the audience what your process is? Because I know every psychic medium, every channeler, they all have different ways of connecting to the other side. So what is your process? I mean, do you see dead people? Do you hear them? Do you feel them? Or is it like, I always like, is it like ghosts? Do they come in through you like they did with Whoopi Goldberg? What is your process?
It's really, it's amazing how it's evolved over the years. Mm-hmm. In the beginning, I used to see them, yes. Not the way I see you and I, you know, mm-hmm. and in what I work from is my subconscious. You realize that right now you and I are using our conscious mind. So we're focused on what's in front of us, right? Mm-hmm. But when we go to sleep at night, our conscious mind goes to sleep and your subconscious comes up. And the subconscious is working at the same time your conscious mind is. That's what sees all the way around you. So I can fluctuate in between subconscious and conscious mind, always have been able to do that. But over the years of using this ability, like I said, if you exercise something, you can become an Olympic player at it. Well, that's what happened to me. It has evolved. Now it's to the point where, I mean, people always say, oh, you're so lucky. And, you know, that's such a blessing. And I wish this and I wish that. And I have a younger brother who is adorable, and he doesn't have this ability. And he always would say to me, I wish I had that ability. I wish I had it. I want to hear Harold, my brother who passed away. And I always used to say to him, honey, until you really have it, you don't know what you're wishing for. Because there's an old saying, be careful what you wish for. Mm-hmm. Because now that I'm at this stage of my life, like you said, you know, I want to be in control of my whole consciousness around me. When you're younger, you don't think about the things that could happen to you when you're older. So you just give into it. But now I'm at a point where I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. I need to be fully aware of what's going on around me. I'm not getting any younger, you know? So I have asked them very politely how they can go about giving me messages and what my boundaries are. Because when I was younger, I didn't have any boundaries. I would take all messages. And in that process, I would get sometimes evil things that would try, you know, what I would call prankster spirits. So I didn't know how to handle that. But over the years, I've learned so many tools and I now put them all to work. I start out every day saying I'm grounded in the power of God because my faith in God is huge. Now, I won't say to you that I follow a religion. Mm-hmm. Yes, I think in terms of Jesus and Mary, I just happen to love them. But I can honestly say I respect all religions as long as they respect everybody else. You know, in fact, I love this question. I ask people many times when I'm with new people out to dinner, if you had an opportunity to go to dinner and have a conversation with somebody either dead or alive, who would you want to have dinner with that you could talk to and ask a million questions to? They don't have to be alive. They can be from 500 years ago. Who would you want? And most people always say things like, oh, I don't know, Henry VIII, Marilyn Monroe, you know, whatever, president. But my answer would, of course, I would love to meet Jesus. I would, sure. You know, I'm not good enough to shine his shoes, but I'd love to hug him or just look at him and kiss him if I could, because and on his hand, you know, because I know how great a person, a soul he was. But anyway, I have evolved and now I can do things that even astound me. And I'm not bragging. I hope that doesn't sound that way because there are things when I'm doing work for people that I'll even sit back that they have just told me that. And now I'm saying that. And the person tells me, Concetta, there's no way you could have known this. You know it. I love when that happens because I feel like I'm doing my job. You know what I mean?
So do you, so there is, so now there's Alex, a clue.
Excuse me, I forgot to tell you. Yeah. I swear like a Jersey girl too. So
that's okay. We have ways of taking care of that in post. So there is a closed sign now. So you have an open sign and a closed sign. You've set boundaries because that I've again heard this from other psychic mediums at the beginning. Yeah. It's wide open and you can't be wide open because it's too much.
Ooh.
You've got to really set up that I'm open for business. I'm closed for business. So then the question is, do dead people watch you taking a shower?
Well, honey, here's what you got to know. Most folks don't mind if God watches them shower. They just don't want their grandmother to watch them. You know what I mean? So but in all fairness, that's what it really comes down to. But you have to know that when we leave this side and we're not in the physical form anymore, we're in the energy form. And provided you choose God, which I encourage everybody, choose God. When you get out of your body, that's the first thing you get before you. Do you choose God? And those folks that don't choose God, well, I've met some of them, some gangsters from New Jersey who I know would be afraid of God for retribution, whatever. Not my, you know, I would say don't be afraid because God is so loving. But anyway. I'm sorry. Were you right?
I was about to say something when you said that, because I have experience with mobsters, as well as many of my listeners know, I almost made a movie for a mobster, and he was from Jersey, if I'm not mistaken. I think he was New York or Jersey. He was definitely of the Italian persuasion, to say the least. But isn't it funny? Every time you see drug dealers, gangsters, mafiosos, there's always a church scene in a movie. They're always praying to God. They're always doing the Hail Mary, and then they go out and kill somebody. It is fascinating. And across cultures, you can watch Narcos, you can watch The Godfather, you can watch all the mafia stories.
Yeah, that's so true. But
isn't
so
it amazing?
Movies. Yeah, it's true. Let me just say this. I always tell people, you didn't come to Earth to be perfect. You came to be faithful. So you don't have to worry about being perfect. Just be faithful. Choose God. And it doesn't matter what religion you are. Just choose God. And I always look at it like I'm not perfect, but I do know I didn't kill anybody and bury them in my backyard. So I think I'm still in good graces.
At least that they can prove, Conchita. At least that they can prove. That's always right. Innocent until proven guilty.
Yes, you're right, Alex.
So has there ever been a reading for you that you've had with a client that not only was so profound for the client, but also profound for you?
Oh,
that just
God.
rocked your world.
Oh,
in a way that you
honey, I really hope you'll forgive me for this answer, because there are so many. You know, I've been doing this for a long, long time. So there have been some that have blown me away. And I thought that wasn't the question you were going to ask. I thought you were going to ask me, was there ever anybody I ever spoke to that I didn't hear anybody? But all right, I'll give you one example. Okay, let's see. Well, this is a fun one. We were just talking about it. So I had a mobster come to me one time. And he came to me with two gumadas. Do you know what gumadas are?
Yeah.
So he came here with two gumas, and they sat in my office, and I looked at the appointment was made with one person's name. It was one of the women. So I didn't know who he was. I had no idea. And he looked old as dirt. So I said, this guy looks harmless enough. But he came in with the two gumas, and I did the gumadas first, right? And then when I got to him, I said, there was something really, I don't know how to explain it, but there was something very ugly around the energy. And I said, I don't know where I'm going to go with this. But what I got, and the only thing I got, was his mother. And she was telling me to tell him to repent. And I was like, I don't know who this guy is, whatever. And it started out, it was so funny, because I said to him, I always start out saying, say your name. Because I show the respect to the other side. You tell me your name, they know now you're my subject. And then I say to them, do I have your permission to listen? Because basically, they're talking on the whole hall phone to them, and I'm on the extension listening to everything. You know, that's how I explain to people how I'm hearing this. I'm eavesdropping on your conversation as they're talking to you. So I asked him that. He looked at my table like it was bugged, and it was like, you know, the Senate committee. And he was like, why? What are you going to listen to? I was like, oh, calm down there, baby. And when I said to him, what's your name? He was hesitant to say his name. Long story short, I did what I do, and they left, and I was happy they were gone. Okay, maron. So now, about 3 days later, my husband comes home. Now, you know the old saying, we're not involved in that, but we know who they are. So my husband said, do you know who was here, Concetta? And I said, no, who? And he tells me the guy's name. And I go, I don't know who that is. Who is it? And he goes, he was just released from prison. And apparently his two gumads brought him to your office. I went, oh my God, I think I remember this guy. Because I don't remember anything, but I remembered that stood out. That there was like something very fishy. And I said, oh. So he said, yeah. He said, but you're not going to believe this. I said, what? He goes, Tony No Fingers found me on the job site and asked me if he could get me in. And they started getting all these wise guys coming because, you know, I was booked in advance. So I said, I don't believe it. It was so funny. Yeah. And then the best part was I wrote about it in one of my books. And I changed the names, of course, to protect the innocent. But I was doing a book signing. And somebody at the book signing asked me about the mobster who came. And I made a big joke. I was talking about it. And then after I was doing the book signing, two girls, young, beautiful girls, came up to me and said, that's our uncle. I said, oh, my God. I said, I hope he knows where I live.
Well, my favorite part of that whole story is Tony No Fingers. I mean, that's... the best. I mean, they are colorful.
Everybody in Jersey has a nickname.
It was very, they're always very colorful. Very colorful, yes. Names, to say the least. Oh my God. That's hilarious. So
oh, you were by the way, what I was telling him, what was so profound to him, by the way.
Oh yeah.
Whatever he said, whatever his mother said to him, because he didn't believe in this and he was dragged here by these two women. He had no interest in it whatsoever, but apparently, I don't remember what it was, but whatever it was, he was bowled over by something that was only between him and his mother. And so when he went back to his club, I guess he was telling all the guys there, and that's how the phone call started coming in. Yeah.
Wow. And did you accept all of these clients? No, you didn't. Okay.
No, I don't show favoritism or, you know, if somebody has an appointment, I honor it. And if somebody's kind enough to wait 5 years and then I'm not going to drop them to pick somebody, you know, that's really not nice.
Of course. No, of course.
I wouldn't do that.
Fair enough. Fair enough. So you were saying, like, I thought you were going to ask if I've ever seen anybody that nothing came through. Have you ever had that?
Yes, Alex. It's been very few times. And it's always so heartbreaking because it's not my fault. And I won't make this up. I remember one time in particular, there were three girls. It was early on in my career. And the three girls came to my office. They were so excited. They were young, adorable. So the first two girls that I read was wonderful. They were happy. And I was very grateful that things made them pleased that they came. When I got to the third girl, I looked and I heard zippity-doo-dah. There was nothing, nothing. And I said to her, honey, I am so sorry. I'm not a liar and I can't make this up, but I don't hear anything and I feel really bad and I can't take any kind of pay for this because I'm not going to do it. I have nothing. So the girl ran out of my house crying and I was devastated. I said, oh my God, that poor girl. So her girlfriends were still in my house, in my office. And I said, what happened? What's going on? And then they told me, they said, she lives with her mother. She had lived with her mother. The mother was abusive. She was adorable too. She never had a boyfriend. She always wanted to be married and have a boyfriend. And that she had seen other, I call boardwalk psychics, who gave all information that did not make any sense, and nothing was helping her. Neither was she getting any validations. And I said to myself, my God, I'm so sorry. But when they left, I realized what that was it was a karmic. It was a karmic relationship between the mother and the daughter, and that there was something much more serious karmically going on between the two of them. And I was not privy to hear anything, to do anything. So that made me feel very bad for that poor girl. Oh, but I remember her to this day. And this had to be, my God, 20 years ago. And there were other times, but not many, not many. Alec, most of the time, I will say like 98.9%, there's always dead people around every one of us. But there's that 1% where there's nothing. You know, and I won't try to fudge it. If I don't got it, if I don't get it, I don't got it.
So do you only connect with dead people who've passed on, or are there angels or anything else? Jesus, have you spoken to Jesus? You know, these kind of people.
No.
Or is it strictly just souls that passed?
I speak to Jesus. I speak to him.
It's a one-way conversation though. Yeah.
I speak to him all the time. I'm happy to tell you. And I highly recommend it because I feel we all have our own God squad, meaning that we all have people we've loved and lost, and we have many more that we've never even met that are part of our God squad. But as far as Jesus and Mary, I've seen evidence enough to know. So I assure you, it's real. God is real. They are real. They are, if you ask for their help, they answer. I mean, it's nothing short of a miracle. I'm just an average person, and I don't claim to have anything all that special. I just have this ability that makes me very happy that I have. But I do make sure I point out that these souls, these beautiful people in, I will say Jesus and Mary, they are there, they are here, they're in the air you breathe. And if you spell air, it spells A-I-R, and it stands for always in reach. So remember that, ladies and gentlemen, they're always in reach and available to you.
Now, what is the biggest misconception that people have of psychic mediums?
Well, there's a lot of phonies out there. Mm-hmm. There's a lot, and there's a lot that let it go to their head. I've met them, and I've
real people, real people, like people who actually have the gift, but their ego, the ego's gone out of it. Yeah, I've met
I won't mention any names, but I've met them that are famous. And, you know, today, it's so funny. I was out today and I was talking to somebody and they were telling me they ran into a very famous medium that I won't mention any names. And they said she was so rude and really snapped at them for talking to her on her time. And yeah, like, right. And I said, they said, Concetta, we love talking to you because you don't have that. And you have what they said a lot of nice things to me. So I said, listen, I'm like a net girl next door. And if somebody says hello to me and is happy to see me, why wouldn't I say hello? I'd be happy to see you. But when somebody lets stuff go to their head, it's always a mistake. It never plays out well. And it catches up to you. And believe me, life is short. So, you know, I'm just saying, don't let that go to your head. And I've seen a lot of them that happen to them.
You know what's...
It happens in Hollywood. It happens in people who get power and high positions. It happens to a lot of people. That will never happen to me.
Well, as you know, that I do come from Hollywood and worked in the film industry for such a long time. I'm old enough to have seen the rise and fall of many celebrities, many actors, many directors, many writers. And I've worked with people who were at the height, the ego, the yelling, the insanity, the abuse.
Oh yeah.
But then 2-3 years later, they're gone. Because when you stop making the system money, they're not going to put up with your BS anymore.
Right. That's right. And, you know, I know what you mean, because first of all, I also have met, obviously, you would imagine, right? Word gets out. When I started doing this work, word got out and I started hearing from celebrities that made me say, who called? You know, but whoa. But I met a lot of wonderful celebrities.
Mm-hmm.
But
yes.
I've also met a lot of ones that are their heads so big that we had to have the door frame changed. You know, I mean, just so sad. But it's a sad thing, because this is a human thing. We're all going through a human experience, and nobody here is better than anybody else, you know.
Agreed.
And you know who just, and people find that out eventually, like the Queen. And I love the Queen, don't get me wrong, but I'm sure when she went into the pearly gates, they weren't like 17 servants waiting for her, you know, and saying, yes, your majesty, and what do you want for dinner, and you know, we're going to run your bath water for you. Now she must have found out it's just different, you know. She was fortunate, she had an amazing life, and God bless her. I wish her wonderful happiness in the light of God, but it wasn't the same as here.
You know what? And it's really interesting that you bring up the Queen, because a lot of people think that, oh, the Queen of England, they had so much power and money and this and that. Yeah, but that comes at a price, you know? And I know a lot of people would be willing to pay for that price, by the way. At least they think they do. Just like your brother like your brother who wants your gifts. He's like, until you're in that world, you don't know. You know, fame is a very, very tricky thing.
Oh,
and I've been around fame for a long time. And I've been good friends with people who have been extremely, really famous. Mm-hmm. And I've interviewed people who are extremely famous.
Yeah.
And I asked the question, like, how do you deal with that? Because there's a cost involved.
It is. And I'm not saying I'm famous. I'm not saying I'm all that in a bag of chips, but I will say this. since I've been public and, you know, written these books, I've been very fortunate. I have sadly found out, sadly, the hard way, who are real friends and who are not, you know, and people who want to use you and then, you know, are just greedy. I mean, I found out things being in this profession, you know, and it's sad because that's the part that people who envy other people don't know what those people are going through.
Oh my God. It is. It's one thing to see on a TV screen or on a movie screen or listen to music and you think of these people, oh, their life must be so. There's a cost to all of that. I mean, look, right now, Taylor Swift is the most famous woman in the world.
Yeah.
Right now, everybody in the world knows about her.
Right.
And she's 34 years old. Mm-hmm. I can't even imagine living a day in her life right now.
She's under, yeah. All I can say to that was, just remember, Madonna was that famous one day.
Right. And Michael Jackson. And Michael Jackson was, yeah.
Yeah, but sadly, Michael Jackson has left us. And that's sad because he was such an amazing talent. But Madonna is still here. God bless her. But now she's past the 34 stage. So now she's finding out what it's like to be on the other receiving end of being all that worship and all that. You know, body, soul, and everything, you know.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
You can't hold on to that forever. So you better have, I was just saying it to the same girls I referred to before today. I said, you have to know you're beautiful. You have to feel it and know it. Because if you don't know it when you're young, when you get to this age, it's going to really suck. Because if you don't feel fabulous and know that you're walking, bringing something worthwhile to the table, other people are not going to ever see it, and especially not see it when you're this age. It's just a, yeah.
And you look at someone like Dolly Parton, who,
my idol.
I mean, I love Dolly.
I love her too.
And I mean, and she was a sex symbol. I mean, yeah. and she still is to many people in the world.
Well, that's because her heart is so beautiful and her mind and soul.
Right. And she's just aged with grace and wonder. And she's not trying to be a 21-year-old anymore.
Yeah.
You know, it's.
Love her too, honey.
Yeah. There's
she brings so much good energy. How about we just put it that way? You see her on television, you see her in person, you see her in a movie. Her energy is so vibrant and so positive. Yeah. And you just want to smile when you see her.
Yeah, she's absolutely beautiful. Now, you mentioned something in regards to prankster spirits. I'm assuming that, do you believe in dark spirits, evil spirits, bad things? If they do exist, which people are so fearful of those kind of things, what do you do to protect yourself from them? And what can other people do to protect from that dark energy? Or is that even a thing that we have to worry about at all?
Of course they exist, honey. We're in the midst right now on Earth in a very big battle between good and evil. I mean, you can see it. Just turn the TV on. In 5 minutes, you'll see proof of it if you watch the news. But what I can tell you is that, yes, evil is real. There's no question. We're here. This is Camp Earth. We are here to learn from this experience. That place is home. So when we're here, we're confronted with choices. So much is going on. And we learn from all of it. But evil always is trying to get our attention and trying to get us to sway to evil side. So how do I avoid it? I start every single day with prayer. Every single day. And during the day, I pray too. But morning prayer is very simple. It's just simple. And Lord, please ground me. Ground me in the power and the pillar of God. It's very simple. And then I also lay my ground rules, which is you are not allowed here. So when I start work with clients, I say to them, if you are in the light of God and you have something you want me to say or give a message, I'll be happy to do it, but you must choose God. If you do not choose God, then you got to go right now. And I command that in the name of God. Those are my tools, and I use them all of my life because I suffer from panic attacks, bad, and anxieties. And it's the thing that I think that happens is two things. Number one, it's from past lives, because these fears that I have, there's nothing that happened to me in this lifetime that would warrant me to be afraid and so anxious and nervous. So, and there's been times I've done and seen things from past lives of my own to make me understand. I'll give you an example. I believe in a past life I was Jewish, and I believe that I died in a Holocaust. And I'm, you know, I just believe that. And there's many experiences I had that could back that up. But anyway, these are the things that ground me, make me feel safe. Because when I start to panic, I call God into it. And I say, and I call all the high archangels. I pull it all out. I say, Saint Germain, flood me in the violet light of Saint Germain. And these are the things that I do. And if you try it, you will see that it works. You will feel it. You will feel the energy that is in the light of God flood through you if you allow it and call it.
Now, you mentioned something in regards to going watching television and seeing the evil. There's a battle of for evil, good and evil going on right now.
Yeah.
The world is going through a very big shift right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like we're going to have an interesting decade coming up. What do you see for humanity? Or is there anything that you could tell us in regards to this craziness that's happening right now?
Yeah.
Because a lot of people are afraid and a lot of people are scared of World War III and of all this other stuff. But I'd love to hear your point of view from the other side.
Absolutely. Everybody's afraid, and rightfully so. Without getting political, how about I just say this? Mm-hmm. And I truly believe this. God always wins. He always has. He always will. Mm-hmm. So I have faith. I have faith in humanity. I have faith for the future. And I believe that I don't know how it's going to happen, but it's going to somehow work out. I just don't know the timing of it. I don't know if it's going to be soon or later, but I do believe that we will be at a time in the future where we're all at peace. And wouldn't that be nice? And I pray for that every day. I pray for peace on earth.
So will there be this kind of, and I agree with you, by the way. I do agree that at the end of this road, we're going to be fine. But the question is, how long's that road?
Yes.
And it, you know, and I've heard from others that have been on the show that's like, it's going to be a rough decade.
I don't think it's going to be a rough decade. I disagree with that.
Okay. Tell me.
I don't believe it's going to take 10 years.
Okay.
Nope. Don't believe that at all. No, without saying too much political feelings on that, I just feel that we are headed towards things that are going to bring us to a conclusion. And I hope and pray there is no, you know, wars, no revolution, none of that stuff, no bombs, any of that. I want my faith to be that God is going to rescue us from all of this turmoil and all of this hatred and mean energy that's just every day floating around us. I believe that God is going to rescue us, and I don't believe for a second it's going to take 10 years. No.
Thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Well, and I want it not to because of the kids. I mean, you know,
I know.
You know, it's the children, Alex. I mean, I'm at this stage of my life. You know, how many more good, I kind of want to make it sound like I'm in a hurry, but let's face it, you know, but the children, I want them to have the country I grew up in. I want them to have the life I was fortunate enough to lead and to be happy with their neighbors. And yeah, there's all that stuff. I just want that for kids.
Well, let me ask you this, from your point of view, then why does God or source energy or whatever you want to call it allow this evil to happen in the world? Because that's a question I get asked all the time. Like, how can this happen? How can he allow these wars? How can he allow famine and death and all this stuff?
Yeah, it's very simple, honey. We're learning. Every soul that comes on earth, for however long they stay, we are learning, we are teaching, we are evolving. Things come out of it. There's a domino effect of everything that is happening to the world at large, to every individually, and it's all God, a mission that God has, a plan that God has, that we are as souls to grow and benefit from it. And I don't have all the answers. I only know I have faith. And I do believe that even with the worst tragedies I've heard in my work, and I hear some of the most horrific, I have often said to myself too, or to God, God, why? You know, I mean, these are things, but I come back to the same thing every single time, which is God must know something I don't know. I'm a mere human. I'm a mere little girl from New Jersey. I don't have that privilege to know all of that, but I do have my faith. Easy.
So easy peasy. So
yeah.
with all the experience that you have talking to so many people who have passed on, so many souls who have passed on, what goes on the other side? Is there a bar they all go to?
Oh.
Is there a movie theater? Like, what are they doing? It seems
Oh, Alex, I ask
tell me.
All the time. Uh-huh. I ask all the time. When my brother passed away, I was like, oh, I got somebody on the inside now. You know? I was like, so, okay, I can talk to you now. And then my father joined him. Then my mother joined him. And now I got my God squad. So, and I've got some others that are very dear to me. I've got to mention your name, Roy, because I know you're one of my best dispatchers, my friend Roy. So in all fairness, they tell me the most amazing things. I've asked my own parents, you know, and it's so wonderful what they tell me. The best I can understand, because they always remind me it's not like this side. They always remind me it's not the physical world. It's so different. But I have been made to understand that the minute we get out of our body, we have a choice. So given you chose God, there's a homecoming. You are met by everyone you've ever loved and lost first. And then you meet all these other lovely souls who protected you and loved you the whole time while you were experiencing earth. Now you're brought into this. But they tell me the existence, my mother has said this to me, because when I say to her, when I've spoke to her, Mom, where's Dad? Like, I'm thinking he's going to be by her, sitting by her in the chair like he was when I walk into their home. And she would respond to me, honey, it's not like there. He's here, but it's not like there. So in other words, what she meant was, we don't live in a senior citizen building anymore. And he's not in the living room with me right now, but he's here. So, you know, and when my mother passed, I said, do you see Harold? Because that was his name. I asked her 5 questions the first time I heard her, but one of them was, do you see Harold? And it was so beautiful because she was so sweet. I could hear her voice and she answered me, because that was her son, you know, when he died. And if you have children, you know how horrible that would be. So she was, the way she answered, it was like, oh yes. It was so heartfelt. I said, yay, I was so excited. But they make it clear to me that we have the choice of what we choose on that side. They say it like there's so many different levels of soul. It's almost like this. If you go to school and you only finish first grade, or you only finished 8th grade, or you only finished high school or college, we as souls are in those categories of how our soul growth was. That's the easiest way I know to describe it. Mm-hmm. But we can also help other souls. We can visit. They're with us all the time. They're constantly trying to let us know that they're among us in the air we breathe. They always want us to know that they can help us if we pray for it. I always tell people, listen, if you want help, try it out. This is the best thing to do if you want to see proof that they exist and that they're listening. This is how you do it. I'll use my brother as an example, because he's one of my biggest dispatchers, and he's on 24-hour call with me. So I'll call him. I'll say, Harold, honey, please, I can't find the passports. We really need to find them. I need to find them now. Always at the end of your request, better known as a prayer, just say, in the name of God, hear my prayer. And I'm telling you, I write about this in my books. It's like amazing. My husband looked for the passports for a whole Sunday afternoon, because he was the one who lost them. I was ready to kill him, and because we were invited to go on a trip. And I said, now I got to go to Morristown. I got to figure out how to get these stupid passports. So when I resorted to asking my brother, I've had them in my hand in 10 minutes. 10 minutes. I mean, he led me to where they were. He said, look up, look under that hat. Boom, there they were. And they do that 7 to 8 times out of 10. It will come to fruition. And the 2 or 3 times that they don't answer your request, you must understand God has a better plan and give it your faith. But the odds are great 7 times out of 10. Let me give you an example, Alex. I love this one. The other day, I went to my assistant's house. Her name is Elena. She's not just my assistant. She's one of my best friends. But I went to her house, and she said, I lost my sunglasses. I can't find them. I had them for years. I love them. I said, well, did you look in your car? Because I see them in your car. She goes, I looked a million times in my car. I said, no, they're in your car. They're in the car. They're in the car. Okay, she went outside. She came back 10 minutes later. She goes, and she's a neat freak, not like a lot of junk in her car. She goes, they're not there, Con. I looked everywhere. I said, that's weird, because I really see them in the car. So she said, nope, they're not there. The next day, she called me up. She goes, you're not going to believe this. I said, what? They were in your car? No, they were in her next door neighbor's car. She had gone out for pizza over the weekend with her neighbor. And she goes, I went across the street and looked in her back seat. I saw them in between the seat. I said, hallelujah, at least you found them. But that wasn't them asking for help. But she did do what I told her to do, which was give me back my sunglasses. In the name of God, hear my prayer. I
Fair.
love that story though. It's so funny. I said, I had it right. I just had it wrong car. And
What
that about sums it
you?
up when you talk about mediums, because you're never perfect, Alec.
But you,
You
I was
have
about
moments
to
of.
say, yeah, it's not a perfect. It's look, this is not a science in that sense.
I
You're
try to tell.
interpret, and a lot of people, from my understanding of mediums, you're interpreting
Yes.
visuals that come in a lot of
Subconscious.
times. Yeah,
Subconscious.
exactly. It's like you're not hearing
A
voices per se.
voice.
Are you
No,
hearing voices?
I
No.
used to, but I told you I'm my age, I don't want to hear voices. So I say to them, I don't mind. Tell me what you want me to know, but do not let me hear voices. Listen, I could tell you stories you wouldn't believe, quite frankly, if you had more time. So all I can say is read my books because I write all about them. There are no ghost writers, if you'll excuse the pun. I write it all. But the point is, they are always talking to you in your subconscious. So that's why people will say, oh, I had a feeling about that. Oh, I had a gut feeling. Something just told me all those things. It was a person in your head. And I hear them in my subconscious. I go into a subconscious state. I can fluctuate. I could still run my outside of my body, but I can hear these things that are being said in my subconscious. And it's not
No.
a voice, it's a thought. It's a very loud thought.
Fair
Oh,
enough.
wait, I'll tell you one better way to understand it. Okay?
Yes.
Here's one. So just say you're in the middle of a conversation with somebody and you're really following the conversation. You're into it, right? Not something boring, you're into it. But all of a sudden, in the middle of that conversation, something happened that you went, oh, I forgot to pick up the dry cleaning. I was supposed to pick it up. Well, that was because you had two thoughts at one time, right? But if I told you, I want you to do this right now, in your mind, I want you to count 1 to 10. At the same time, I want you to think in your mind the ABCs. You can't do it. You'll sit there going 1, 2, 3, but you can't do ABC at the same time. But I just proved to you that you do have two thoughts at one time because you were in the middle of a conversation you were really enjoying. But in
Here's
the
something
middle of
else.
it, something else went, hey, you forgot to pick up the milk. You forgot to get the dry cleaning. There's the two thoughts running parallel. So you can do
Right.
it.
But you just can't do it in the conscious. You need to have the conscious and
Right.
the subconscious. Exactly. No,
Exactly.
that's happened. I mean, how many times are you driving a car and then you're thinking about a thousand other things, and by the time you get to your destination, you're like, "How'd I get here? Did
Wait till
I?"
you get to this age, honey.
Now, again, with your experience with spirits, how do they relate to the souls they left behind? As once they pass over, how do they relate to their daughters, their
Better than you
sons,
could
their
ever
grandchildren?
imagine. The fr remember on that side is unconditional love, unconditional forgiveness, no mortgage payments, no health issues. The amazing thing that happens is just, it's so amazing you can't even imagine it because it's nothing you have felt while you're here. Although I shouldn't really say that because I felt it one time. I felt it one time. I was in a state of a terrible anxiety panic attack. I had skin cancer on my forehead here. And I didn't know what I was walking into. So when I went for the surgery, I didn't know what to expect. It was a spot of pep. It looked like a little spot of pepper. People, pepper, Peter, whatever. A spot of pepper was right here on my forehead. And when I went for the surgery, what did I know? I figured, oh, they'll remove it, no big deal. I walked out of the surgery with a scar from here to here, and it was gross. It looked like Frankenstein. Well, I was in the worst state of panic, and it was terrible, terrible. I couldn't imagine how it was going to look when it healed. I had an event to do. Oh. So I went and I was praying. I was praying, praying, please, please help me. Mary, I was praying to Mary. Mary, please help me, honey. I need your help. I need to take this anxiety, this panic out of my body. I beg you, in the name of Almighty God, hear my prayer. Well, anyway, I went to take a shower. This is a true story, Alex. I'm standing in the shower. The water's coming down on me. I literally felt like a spaghetti strainer. I felt the water literally felt like it was going through my body. I felt the best energy I've ever felt in my life. And I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't do drugs. But I felt something that was euphoric that went through my body. It was absolutely insane. The energy of anxiety went right down the drain. Any nervousness, any fear, anything. I looked down at the drain like it was draining. hanging down there. I put the towel around me. I ran downstairs. In my living room, I have a mantle. And on my mantle, I have this beautiful statue of Mary. And as I went down there, I look over at the wall. Now, in my living room, I have paintings, oil paintings. And they're from different places, Italy, France, whatever. But I have this oil painting that's huge. John said, my husband, his name is John. John said it has to weigh 180 pounds. When he hung it, he had to put it on two brackets. It's been there ever since. And he had to stand up the heavy, big thing to put it in place. When I went downstairs, that statue of Mary was like this. And there was no other paintings in my entire living room moved. And there were some on there that were so light, all you'd have to do is go like that and move them. This was the heaviest one. And it was like this. I had to call him. I said, you have to see this because you're not going to believe this. And I want you to remember what you saw in case I call for a witness. And he was even astounded. He had to step up on the couch to place it back in place because it was so heavy. That is a true story. And I felt her. I felt that energy. And I'll tell you what, if that's what it's like and what you feel going to the other side, no fear whatsoever from this girl. My only fear is just like anybody else. How am I going to get there? You know what I mean? I don't mind going. I just want to worry. I don't want to worry about it, but sometimes you do. How am I going to get there? You know?
Well, like they say, everybody wants to go to heaven, just not right now.
No, it's not. I'm having too much fun. Despite now what's going on in this world.
Right. Exactly. Well, then, this is truly an exciting time to be around because of humanity's shift that's going on. Yeah. The consciousness shift. It's just an amazing time to be around. Yeah, it's tough. But, you know, historically, we're probably doing better now than we've ever done, even with all the craziness.
I agree.
Less wars going on than there was 100 years ago, 200 years ago, things like that. It's just an interesting time to be alive. And I think, and by the way, we all chose to be here at this time. We were like, no, we want front row seats to this insanity. This is going to be a good show. And it's happening for sure. Now, from your perspective, what's the most important thing for people to understand about life and death from your perspective as a psychic medium?
Well, first of all, for me, life, what you just said, I apply it to that because we're here to make a difference. And especially in this time, like you said, and if you can make a positive difference to one person or many people, that's saying so much. That says you have a tremendous deposit in your karmic bank account. So try to make that effort. Even if it's a child and if it's if a next door neighbor, it doesn't matter. If you're making a positive effort to make somebody feel better, feel good, or enrich their lives or help them out, whatever it may be, that's part of the experience in the physical form. We're here to learn from that. And if you know that, do the right thing. Be the good person. Be an honest with integrity and those lovely things. As far as death goes, don't be afraid of it. I mean, I don't want to go any more than anybody else does because I'm having a good time. But I can honestly say, don't ever think that there is a scary place waiting for you. There's just no scare in it. It doesn't sting. It's a magical miracle. They tell me and I believe them. And I've seen enough in my lifetime to know it's true. I've witnessed enough. I have heard enough to know that it's true. So that's where my conclusion comes from. All that I've experienced and seen and heard from them. No fear.
Now I have to ask you, your book, I Kissed a Ghost and I Liked It. Did you truly kiss a ghost?
Oh God, yeah. I did.
How did that work, my dear?
Well, let me just tell you, I've never cheated on my husband, but this one ghost, I seriously thought, was this cheating? Because there were two experiences to be exact. One time it was in, we weren't living here. I was living in another home with my husband, and I woke up in the middle of the night and there was a spirit on top of me. I was laying on my back. There was a spirit on top of me. Literally woke up because I felt like I was engaged in sex. Mm-hmm. And but I could smell this foul smell. And it wasn't friendly. It wasn't fun. So my subconscious knew what was going on and it woke up my conscious mind. It was before I was public. It was before I had many tools. So I only had one tool, and that was the tool my father taught me. And this is what happened. This soul was right here, and I woke up physically wanted it off of me. I wanted it gone. And I was trying to do that with my arms. So I was going like this, but my arms were doing something to a spirit. So I literally felt the spirit hold each arm and go like that and
Wow.
hold me down. And I remember being so frightened, but in my mind, I remember what my father taught me. So what I did in my mind was visualize, because I couldn't do it because my hands were being held. I visualized this and I went like that because my father taught me that. Always remember that you can pull your spirit to your body by doing this. And but you're doing, you're calling God also, God into it. And the minute I went like this in my mind, it went up and it was gone. And I remember I was laying there going, oh my God, what the hell was that? That's why I wasn't so sure when my brother wanted me to go public that I should do it, because I said, I don't know what I'm inviting in, because I experienced these kinds of things before I ever went public. So I wasn't sure. But anyway, a second time it happened, I'm going to laugh when I tell you this, because the second time again, and it was, you know, years in between, 20 years in between, I was sleeping one night and I, in my subconscious, at first I thought I was dreaming, but I was engaged in having an encounter, let's just say. Okay. But anyway, all I know is, was it fine? I was like thinking, oh my God, this is so sweet. This is so great. And I remember realizing, because my conscious mind again started to wake up, but it was so good that I remember thinking, hey, what are you doing tomorrow night? I mean, you know, it was just so good. So when I remember waking up thinking, I'm laying next to my husband, I really hope that wasn't considered cheating, because I've never cheated on him in my marriage, you know? And I thought to myself, that was unbelievable. Which, by the way, he never came back, but.
But so I have to ask you, all right, so I have to ask you on both of those occasions, one was the one that you were unhappy with, the negative part.
Yeah.
Was that because I imagine sex is not a thing on the other side.
Here's what you got to know. They remember the physical body. They remember the physical world. So right. They can stimulate, they can do all kinds of things energy wise, but they're not having the same physical feel that we have. And they do miss that. They do miss that.
So, but that was someone forcing themselves upon
you. Yes, it was. Obviously an evil spirit.
Okay. So then on the positive side, do you ever find out who that was?
No, I never did. I'm sure he was like, I would call a prankster spirit. You know, honey, there's always souls around us and we go places. I mean, I've visited historical places where real horrible stuff has taken place. Mm-hmm. I've also visited places where real wonderful stuff taken place. So you got to protect yourself when you go in that environment, because there's residue and this is in the air we breathe. So all you have to do, and I tell it all the time, stay plugged into God. You are safe. You have nothing to worry about, because God is your ally and the big guns in town and will protect you.
And it's fascinating that the positive ghost, for lack of a better word, is when you say the word ghost, is it ghost or are you using that for lack of a better term?
I use that word because that's what people are comfortable with.
Got it. Okay. So it's not like a literal, you know, like Ghostbusters hanging on top of you. You didn't see anything. You just felt everything.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And it the first time, isn't the last time. And it's happened in between, just not as much as those two things I just told you.
So then let me ask you this. We have so many souls and spirit guides and angels around us at all times,
right,
protecting us. How did they allow this to happen? If you
have they allowed it to happen, what's happening on the earth? Or
you in those two scenarios.
Oh, okay. Because, you know, it's interesting. It's like people will say to me, can you find Elvis for me? No, I can't just conjure him up, you know? But if I had Lisa Marie here, well, even sadly she's passed, but if I had Priscilla. I'd be able to get them, or at least I think I would. And, but their flow, I don't know how to say it in terms that would, I like to make it more easy for people to understand. So I'll put it this way, okay, on layman's terms. They're like these things are floating around all the time, coming and going. There's another dimension. There's a place they are. And we can be visited by, you've heard other people, I'm sure, give testimonies. They were visited by their next door neighbor's grandmother. Why did they come to me? I mean, people have said that to me. Why did I hear her father? You know, I don't know. He stopped by. Your subconscious might have been open to it. Your subconscious might have been the one that was more open to this and listened to it and identified it. And remembered it, but that person who's your friend who hasn't heard from her father, she might be shut down in her subconscious. Her subconscious might not be willing or open to even the possibility. There's so many things that are happening at the same time.
Got it. Okay.
You know?
That makes sense. That makes sense. I could keep talking to you for hours.
I love you.
I do as well. I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all of my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Oh, wow. God, Alex, you know, I know you're a wonderful man with great energy, so I'm sure you can relate to this. There's got to be so many things. But I guess if I had to pick one, oh, God, I guess this would be it. Oh, my God, I'm getting choked up. I think it would be the most wonderful thing in my life, if I could say it was the most fulfilling, would be to be loved and to be able to love back. I just love being loved, Alex. And I love to love other people. So if I had to say one thing that fulfilled me the most in life, that would be it.
What is love then?
Yeah, isn't that a beautiful thing? Well, let's put it this way. You know when you got it, and you love when you give it. So it's an energy that is so endearing to the soul that you never forget it. So even somebody you may have loved a long time ago that's not around anymore or not in your life anymore, you remember that love. You can't forget it. It's like a memory that's marked on your soul forever.
It's like it's an ether, if almost in your own ether.
Oh,
it's
isn't
amazing.
It though?
It's beautiful.
It is. Yeah. It's almost like when you go for a colonoscopy and you're knowing you're going to get that great sleep for 5 minutes. Throw that in. Sorry. You got me all choked up over here. So I had to throw some humor in there.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Now, if you had a chance to go back in time and talk to little Concetta, what advice would you give her?
Oh, wow. Oh, I would love to do that too, boy. Back to the future. Okay. I would probably tell her, don't let the people that try to talk you into feeling good about yourself have any power over you. Don't let that happen. You have the power. That's what I would say.
Beautiful. How do you define God or source?
My favorite, I have so many favorite things while I'm in the physical form, but I think my favorite thing while I'm in the energy form to feel safe with and comfort with is God. I love God so much. I believe in God. I know that God is real. So I know all that God has given me, given us, the glory of God, the peace of God, all these wonderful things. I just feel so good being wrapped in the thought of it.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To learn, to love, to give. Oh, to respect. I mean, all those lovely things they tried to teach us when we were kids. And we have a hard time as we get to be adults because so many people piss us off. But, you know what I mean? But we ultimately, if we can learn to overcome that, I work on that all the time because I have terrible road rage. I mean, I'm like, get out of my way. And here's the problem with that. Somebody one time told me, Concetta, you have such a clear memory of when you were in energy form and you knew how to get from place to place in energy form quickly. So you have no patience for a car wheel. And you know what? That just makes so much sense to me. But I try to really work on it.
I think a lot of people have that same problem.
I admit it, though, you know?
Yes. So where can people find out more about you, the amazing work you're doing, and any of these amazing books that you have out?
Thank you, sweetheart. Well, anywhere, I'm on social media all over, Instagram, Facebook. I have my own website. So yeah, I'm on all that, you know, social media. Just put in my name. It should pop up.
All right. And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Oh God, let me think 1 second. My parting message is, first and foremost, if I offended anybody by my language or my sense of humor, I apologize. Second of all, really, really, really try very hard to love people that don't want to love us back, and try to see either their side of it or give it a chance to forgive whatever it is you're upset about. And just know that we are all here to love each other despite our differences. That's what we're here for. So try to do it. It's not easy, but try.
Concetta, it has been such a pleasure and honor speaking to you. You are a hoot. It has been one. I love your energy. Thank you for not only being on the show and sharing your story and your wisdom with all of us, but for everything you do in this world. So thank you, my dear.
Let me just say to you, thank you, sweetie. And if you ever get in my neck of the woods, let me know you're coming. I don't think you'll want to stay here because I know you probably are used to the finest hotels, but because you've been all through Europe, but I will guarantee you the best Italian dinner you've ever had.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much, my dear.
Just let me know you're coming over, baby.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.